better than Harry Potter is Sue Green and Gary Green. They are here in person. They are not apparitions. They are real people, but they're magical people, absolutely magical people. So I am going to turn this over to them, but first we need to give them a round of applause because they are very busy people. They have many things going on, and we really need to thank them for being here. So with a round of applause, we're going to turn this over to Sue.
Okay, I'm Sue.
This is Gary.
And we both, we're not brother and sister. So we work at the Paramount Theater and have had other careers along with, before, and during, and not yet after, since we're both still there. So we're going to tell you a little bit about that. You guys were just talking about arts dollars and free tickets for UVA students. Sometimes those free tickets will take you to events at the Paramount. There was one just recently, I think the National Endowment for the Arts, where there were free tickets and somebody that you might know about that I'm going to talk about later. But anyway, first we're just going to show you a real quick video that tells you a little bit of the history of the Paramount, and then I'll talk a little bit, and Gary will talk a little bit, and we'll take questions, and whoops, wait a minute, hang on, that's not what was supposed to happen.
Has anybody been to the Paramount ever before?
Yeah.
Only a few of you. Okay. All right. This is an old 1931 theater downtown. If you haven't been.
Back in the 30s, Charlottesville was a thriving little community because of the UVA. And there was no real arts venue in this community. So in 1931, they started construction of the Paramount Theater. Through the years, they had music and entertainment of all kinds, and movies especially. And people from all over Central Virginia came to enjoy what was happening at the Paramount. This was just a street. There was no downtown mall, pedestrian mall, obviously. So now, here we are, the Paramount is the lively center of the downtown. Importantly, very importantly, it's such a huge economic driver because people who come here for performances or various events eat at the restaurants, they shop at the shops, and so it really does flavor what is happening on this downtown mall.
Thank you.
Hope you guys liked it. All right. There's and it's changing because every year we now have at least 250 events. Some are music, some are theater, some are speakers, a little bit of everything. Some are weddings if anybody wants to get married. Some are big parties.
Bar mitzvah on stage.
Yeah, pretty much everything. Mm-hmm. So one of the things about the theater is it's a real asset to our community, but it's not like it's just an add-on, it actually is the community. And we really hope you guys will get involved so you become a part of that community. There is so much networking that goes on, so even just from a career perspective, it's kind of cool. But you also just meet lots of new people, try some new things, tap into skills that you maybe didn't even know you had. And that's kind of what happened with us. Mm-hmm. We started out as volunteers. He was a volunteer for about a half of one shift. I was a volunteer for several years, and then I became a paid person. I never anticipated doing this ever in my life. I started out thinking, well, I went to Mount Holyoke, nice Ivy League women's school, a lot of very successful graduates. And I thought I was going to go to medical school. And I was, in fact, invited to go to medical school. And this was back in 1976 when women were just getting into medicine. So it was really cool. But I made a decision to take a year off. And during that year, instead of going to Harvard, I went ahead and got married and had a kid. Then I went to graduate school for teaching just up the street from Harvard in Cambridge. And eventually moved down here, started teaching. So I've been teaching 39 years. I've been a special ed teacher, mostly at the high school level. Got a lot of experience with a lot of kids and a lot of situations. Really enjoyed it. Found out that I really am a people person. Found out teaching gives you an awful lot of skills as well. Gary and I met, and he plays music a lot. And I found that I had some time on my hands because he was on the road and I needed something to do. So I started working at the Pavilion, which, how many of you guys have been to the Pavilion? Anybody? Never been to the Pavilion downtown? Oh, you need to go
We've got to get you off the corner.
You need to go downtown to the Pavilion. They have free concerts every Friday starting in, I think, April, and then lots of really good paid concerts. So you need to do that. But anyway, I started working there as a security guard, which was kind of a shock because at the time I had broken my elbow and I was in a cast from here to here. And I was like, really? You're going to hire me to do security? And they're like, yeah, you can get trained. It's more what's in between your ears. So the second year, I found myself running security for a staff of 50 for concerts that had 3,000 people or more, along with a gentleman friend who is actually a police officer. So I did that for 7 years, and we had big concerts. We had President Obama twice, some really cool experiences. But meanwhile, I was also volunteering at the Paramount and having some really cool experiences there. So I want to know, would you rather yell or raise your hands? Yell. Okay. One person. Thank you, whoever you were, for being brave. I'm going to tell you three or four things, and you're going to yell. I'm going to tell you what they are real fast, and I'm going to go through them again real fast, and you're going to just yell truth or liar, and we're going to hear which one sounds more true or like a lie in your opinion, and then I will show you. All right. So first one is that Morgan Freeman asked me to pose in a picture with him. Second one is that I held hands with the Dalai Lama. The third one is that I performed CPR on a patron and saved that person's life. And the fourth one is that Kathy Griffin asked me to come on stage and be a part of her gig. All right, so again, real fast. Morgan Freeman picture, truth or lie?
True.
Okay. Kathy Griffin asked me to come on stage. Hold hands with the Dalai Lama.
Lie.
CPR on a patron.
False.
All right, we have lots of mixed opinions. Oh, I also got to work at Bonnaroo. Anybody ever heard of Bonnaroo? Been to Bonnaroo? Yay! Okay,
more,
I also
more
worked
been
a lock-in.
To Bonnaroo than downtown.
This is when I wasn't doing security at Bonnaroo. I got to dance to Stevie Nicks and Tom Petty. Notice, this was a highlight in my life. If you get involved at the Paramount, you can meet lots of cool people. The Secret Service behind him, State Department Secret Service, this man, who's like been an idol of mine forever, grabbed my hand and off and on for 3 hours held my hand. You guys, if you volunteer, you just don't know what could happen. It could be really cool. So I'm going to just show you a few other slides of some of the other amazing experiences I've had there. I also will tell you that I'm the coordinator for security, have been. Right now some roles are changing, but because I had worked security actually at the stadium, at JPJ, at Bonnaroo, at Hampton Coliseum, lots of different places, while still teaching. And believe me, teaching high school is a good gig to help get you ready to do security. It's a perfect gig. Where was I with all of that? I don't remember.
You're going to the next one.
I will be going to the next slide. Oh, I also started managing the volunteers. We have a number of volunteers who work every event. Another way you guys could get involved, we'll tell you more. But who do ushering and that kind of thing, and working with hospitality. So kind of doing everything at the theater. So now I'm an event manager as well as security, and show you a few pictures. Anybody know who that is? Lieutenant Dan. Bingo, good job. Bo Diddley. You can tell my hair's changed a little bit over the years. Mm-hmm. Anybody know who that is?
Neither.
DMB? Nope. Boyd Tinsley from Dave Matthews Band.
That's Boyd
on
and
the
Carter.
Left. And Carter.
Right.
Okay. Mm-hmm. See? You get to see your heroes up close and in person. All right. Anybody know who that guy is?
John
Lewis. Yes. Very good. Awesome. And how about the guy on the left? Your left, yeah. No, your right, left.
They spoke the same night together on
at
stage.
At the Festival of the Book. Does anybody know who it is? Okay, if I do this and you think Olympics, John Carlos, he was the guy, he's been referenced recently in terms of the football player who's doing the kneel down thing. John Carlos did something like that back during the Olympics, and he's written a book. He's actually became a high school guidance counselor later in his life, but that was kind of a big honor to meet him as well. Mm-hmm. All right, anybody know? Okay. Mm-hmm. Lily Tomlin, Paula Poundstone, you might know her, them. What about this guy? Jack Hanna, Jungle Jack Hanna. You get to pose with his live cheetah.
Who peed on the floor.
Yes, he did. All right, so this guy who's on your left was just at the theater recently. It was one of those free UVA events. Mm-hmm. Salman Rushdie. He was an awesome speaker. If you guys ever have a chance to hear him, now I understand why people really enjoy his talk. He's really, really good, and he teaches. On the left is kind of a blurry picture, but anybody ever hear of Watergate?
Yeah.
Okay? Those are the two guys, Bernard and Weinstein. Woodward and Bernstein, who broke that story. What about this guy? Anybody know him? He played at Obama's first inauguration. Yo-Yo Ma, very good. And this guy, you might have seen him once or twice. So I was the person who got to be behind the theater greeting him as he came in. Volunteers did see him inside, so if you volunteer, that's the kind of thing that might happen. And then of course I got that, which was kind of cool. And then my personal favorite at the moment, besides the Dalai Lama, and you can see the whole crew got to meet her and have a picture. I don't show everybody the whole crew picture. I just show them that one, but I have to be honest with you guys and show you the whole crew picture. So I never intended to be a teacher, but I ended up being a teacher for 39 years. While being a teacher, I decided to volunteer. I got into the security thing because I had some time on my hands, and I have a whole life, a whole circle of friends. I retired from teaching a year ago. And I'm working almost full-time doing event management and security, and it's really cool. I hope we'll see you guys down at the theater sometime. Gary.
Well,
about the volunteer report. Is that at the end? Do you have programs? Did you want to give them programs right now?
We do want to give them programs. Do you want to do it after you talk or right now?
Whenever.
Okay. I'll walk around and hand them out while he does his thing. How's that?
Sure. We can unplug you for we're on a little of. What Sue's point is that the Paramount is not just it's not just an arts venue, which the arts is incredibly important to any community, as you guys know. It's important to what brings everybody together. It defines almost the value of a town, in a sense, like ours. Like one of the very first things that the woman on that video said was, Charlottesville used to be just the University of Virginia. And now, since we opened about 12 years ago, then you've had JPJ, and then you've had the Jefferson Theater, and you've had the Pavilion down there. And now, arts has the whole arts attraction is one of the, I don't know, it's one of the focal points of this whole community, where it is what keeps the community from being experiencing a brain drain. People that are educated here, like yourself, would in the past leave, but now because of the art institutions in town, they're all staying. Like Sue, I started here before any of this was going on here. I didn't even begin college until I was 27 years old. When I was your age, I was probably on the Interstate 64 with a jackhammer at midnight, chipping up the road. You have no idea the different stages in your life, where you're going to be and what you're going to be doing. So it was about when I was about 27 is when I first took my college class. I moved down. I'm a blue-collar New Hampshire boy, where no one went to college, but I came down here and ended up doing such. And but to get me through college, I played music a little bit. But I want to. Sure.
Are you ready?
Yeah.
Okay.
Sure. Yeah.
Okay, and you know you can advance this way.
Okay. Thank you.
Actually, you can't because that's a PDF. That's a movie.
No, it shouldn't be.
Yeah. It's just a picture.
Well, just leave it. I'll let you try to figure out what that's all about in a second. So Sue and I. After I went to UVA, I graduated from here in, I think it was in 88, and I ended up teaching at Albemarle High School locally. What got me through college, basically, so I could afford to, was playing music. So we're coming back to the arts at every angle here. This is what got me through college, being able to afford to do it. And I know you're sitting here wondering, what the heck is this all about? But this is actually good that it's up here, because it makes no sense at the moment. And this is where Sue and I met. And as she said, when the Paramount opened, I had been touring, playing this little silly instrument all over the place. She and I taught together for many, many years, and we did our first stint to go volunteer at the Paramount, like what she said. I volunteered for 15 minutes, and then I was working. And I worked there for a year, and then after 20 years of teaching, I was offered a job to work at the Paramount. So I'm at this place now. I'm playing music little bit, but I also went to college so I could teach high school. I taught high school, and I had to make a big decision. What do I do now? I had a part-time sound company. I loved playing music. I loved teaching, and I had to make a decision. I had an opportunity to leave teaching and not do that quite yet, but work at the Paramount. I am the venue's audio engineer. at the theater. Everybody that you just saw on stage, I got to speak with at a level like this and discuss with them what we were going to be doing. I got to mix B.B. King. I got to mix Bill Clinton. I got to mix the Dalai Lama. I got to interact with all of those people. And to be honest with you, it never, ever, ever, ever gets old. You get used to it. You don't get all starstruck like you kind of do the first time when people like this show up on a regular basis. But eventually you just kind of come to this place. But I'll tell you, I could have stayed teaching and I never would have had any of those experiences. I never would have been able to interact and meet and have conversations with any of those people. And again, it's, you know, keep going back to the arts and how important it is and how it brings people together. And the other part is, you know, we've said it like half a dozen times already, you guys are all probably 19, 20, and you have an idea of what your life is going to be, and there isn't anybody that you talk to, especially our age, even a whole lot younger, that their life is anything like what they thought it would be. The person you love right now, you may not love 5 years. I mean, it's just everything just, and it's important to be open to it. It's all going to happen. It's all going to, you're all going to be faced with it. And along those same lines, and we want to tie this back into the Paramount. You guys here are here at UVA, and we asked how many people had been down to the theater, and it's like four of you. I just would like to be able to come back here in the spring, and somebody asked that same question of you, and you've all come down to see, because this town is a special place. A lot of people move here, go to school, or like I moved here and Sue moved here, no intention of ever staying, and this town is really special. A lot of it is because of downtown. A lot of it's because of the university and what you guys all bring. But we really want you to experience this town because there's no other town out there that's quite like this. So anyways, I'm at this funny place where I'm trying to figure out what to do. I left teaching. I'm the house audio engineer at the Paramount. I've mixed 1,000 people you've heard their names of before and had to deal with them, which is, like I said, exciting. But it was this gig here that's now I'm at 60. I'm at this place where I'm changing again. I'm going to go back to what got me into this thing in the first place, which is playing this thing, which I'm going to show you in a little. I don't know. Did you tell them about any of this?
Actually, not too much.
Okay. I was really fortunate back in the late 80s, there was a harmonica contest, and I entered it. And anybody heard of Blues Traveler? Okay, John Popper entered it too. John Popper lost to me. So, yeah. Though I would much rather have his career, though. So that got a lot of things happening for me with this instrument, and I was really happy, and I was really proud, and I've played on probably 70 or 80 different people's album projects. I've played with lots of different people on stage, opened for them. It's one of these instruments that I'm on a crusade my entire life to keep it out of people's perception as should be in the case beside the kazoos. It's not the Bob Dylan instrument. It's well, if you've heard John Popper, you kind of have an idea. He and I are somewhat similar. Well, this picture here gives you an idea. This is the gig that changed me and wanted me to switch back. I had almost stopped playing. I was a good player, and I'd almost stopped playing completely because of my Paramount gig, because I was so enthralled with the technology from mixing and the art of it all. And then I got this gig. This was a two-week gig where a friend of mine and I were sent by the State Department to Afghanistan. And as you would initially think, is you're going over there to play for the troops. Well, it had nothing to do with playing for the troops. It was, we were going over there, and we were going to start a project working with Afghanistan musicians, with Afghanistan traditional instruments. So here you have Americans with American traditional instruments, and you have Afghanis and their traditional instruments. So for 2 weeks, we toured around the country. It was very, very strange, very, very scary at lots of different times. But towards the end, our core was to work with this group of Afghan musicians in Herat, which is, there is a Herat University. Is anybody here from Afghanistan or anywhere over there by chance? Well, this particular concert, this is the first time it's ever happened. This is the Citadel, which is Alexander the Great's Citadel. This is the King's Court. And never has it happened before. You can't see too many of the people that were down here for it. But this was the first time that American and Afghan musicians had ever played together in the Citadel, in the King's Court before. It was an incredible experience. Iran came out and blasted the concept of this happening in such a sacred place in the Middle East. All the news agencies jumped on top of what was happening. It was really kind of interesting, especially at the time, because it was this little diplomacy project that turned into this giant thing at the time. And so after this experience, in getting back to what kind of what I did best, I thought, I'm at that place now of where I am making another career change gradually, but I'm going to leave the theater and go back into playing music. So it's this, the whole point of this is that your whole lives are fluid and you are going to go do something, you're going to get out of it, you're going to do it again maybe or not or find something, and it's all going to be interconnected. Now, to play that video thing. Yeah.
So this change will be very gradual, though. It's because we're old and retiring. It's mm-hmm. not for lack of love for the arts at the Paramount. One of the ways that you could get involved, or if you know anyone else who's potentially interested in any kind of career,
might have to
or even hobby, side hobby in production, whether mm-hmm. it's lighting, stage work, audio engineering, anything like that, they do have internships for that kind of thing, mm-hmm. hands-on stuff. There are other internships more on the business end of things, like marketing, if that's something you're thinking you might be interested in. Development, that's a huge one. Grant writing is another one. If anybody wants a part-time job, come see me. Mm-hmm. We're looking for people to work concessions. You can sign up for whatever number of shifts you want. We'd love to get some young people in there. It helps if you're old enough to serve alcohol by yourself, but it's not critical. You can be 18 as long as somebody like me is around. So just saying, mm-hmm. there are lots of ways to get involved. Okay.
I'm just going to play this for you. But I want to play something live too, but this is something I did at the Paramount not too long ago. All those famous people that were on our stage, well, I've had the opportunity to play there half a dozen times. And this is a piece that I did with Callie here. I don't have a piano here, so I'm going to just let you hear this. Yeah.
Thank you.
So I didn't want to let that play all the way through because it just keeps on going and going and going. But it's a really nice piece, and it's not the, it's not that kind of harmonica which most Americans, kind of gravitate to. But does anybody have any questions? I'm going to play one little piece, and then we're going to... Yes, sir.
I know the answer. We'll see what he says.
No. A lot of people ask that question, and the honest answer is, I had two great friends of mine when I was about your age. They were both great guitar players, and we'd all go places together, and they'd be playing, and I'd be like this, and all the people that looked like you,
girls,
you and girls,
the people who
would
were
be
girls,
like this with the with the guitar players, and I'd be, So yeah. Anyway, but I wanted to be the lead guitar player, but I was way far behind. So.
So before he plays you out, I'm going to interrupt because I can do that.
You can.
As a wife and a woman. In your programs that you have, you'll find a listing of some but not all of the events that are going on. And toward the back, and they didn't number these pages, which my teacher heart does not like because I can't tell you to turn to page such and such. But I can tell you near the back, you'll find a list of volunteers. We would love to add your name to that list. It's a very low-term commitment. You don't have to show up, more than a couple of times a year if you want to, but we train you. You can do everything from working education shows, which, by the way, are really awesome. They have 9 productions this year, which will reach about 15,000 kids. So if you're at all interested in working with kids, you can be a part of this community, and you can put it on your resume. It's never too early to start building your resume. And they have a listing here of what these kids' shows are. They're everything from social justice to storytelling to everything. They're really kind of cool. There's something called the Access Fund, which is talked about here, where there are tickets made available to all kinds of organizations that are nonprofits and reach out and do things for various parts of our community. One thing you may not know about the Paramount is that back in the day, prior to civil rights, it was segregated, and the balcony was for the African Americans, and everybody else sat downstairs. The most expensive seats in the house are now in the balcony, which I think is lovely, ironic justice. But there's a lot of history there. And there's a big part of the mission of the theater is to, in fact, build community, and part of it's in recognition of that. So please come and check that out. We also do tours, so if you want to do a tour, go to theparamount.net, find out when the tours are going on. You can come backstage. You can see all kinds of signatures on the wall, including Bill Clinton and Yo-Yo Ma and Lily Tomlin and all those people. It's kind of neat to see what they write. Ryan Adams was there. He did a really cool picture on the wall, actually. Student rush tickets, if that's something you would be interested in. 45 minutes, yeah, because you're all probably sort of broke. 45 minutes before any performance, if you show up at the theater in person and you want to buy a ticket, you can get it half price. So look into that. I don't think it works for Film Festival, which is coming up real soon. That's a rental. A lot of people rent and have their events at the theater. Not everything is just a Paramount production. But if you're interested, give the box office a call. And please consider coming down. Like Gary said, we'd love to hear from Steve that he asked the same question 5 months from now, and you've all been there. And if you want a job, event manager, tell you want to be an event manager. If you want to intern, marketing, there's some accounting
stuff. We're accepting technical interns, working all these shows, working with crew, working with the visiting tour crews, working backstage. If you have any interest in audio, in lighting, any kind of AV stuff, we are... we're interested in having you come and work with us. And you get credit if you can work it out with your people here. We've had at least a dozen interns over the course since we've been there, and they all go on and work in the industry. We kind
of a lot of them go on and work at the theater. So if you're 18 or 19 and you intern and you like it and you want to come back and get paid, that can often happen because it's it's really an advantage to have people who know what they're doing, who know the actual building. Another way you can volunteer is to come in and help with mailings. So it's not even during a show, but you still can accumulate hours towards getting a free ticket, which is kind of cool. I'd really recommend volunteering with a friend or two because it's just more fun. And being totally honest, most of the volunteers are like our age or older. We'd love to see some fresh faces and kind of build that. So, you know, come with your friends. Mm-hmm. It could be a blast.
Yeah. And now you know two of people.
And so while he plays you out, right. I'm going to give you one more small gift that's actually more of a gift than a program from the Paramount.
So I'm just going to make some noise. Part of my mission with this instrument is to, you know, create a different perception among people. When I moved to Virginia, I was playing in a blues band. I mean, had been playing in a blues band. I moved down here, and they made me play country. But as you've heard, I play lots of different things. So I'm just going to play something that might be familiar, might not be familiar. This is the only instrument. Please,
tell me if you can think of another one where there's only a single modality. Every other instrument, it's you hear it and you have a fingering of something that you can play to, so that your brain's getting two components of information to help you learn music or learn anything about it. This is totally, it's one modality. There's no fingering, there's no anything. So when you say, how do you do anything? It's really complicated. I have to explain with what's going on here. But UVA and me, back in the late 80s, we were the first people to go into an MRI machine and be able, I got 100 different plastic harmonicas where I could do the technique, and we went into an MRI machine, and we have MRI imaging of what's happening in our mouth to do that. We were the first. Somebody's done it a couple of years ago again, but we were the first.
So, we want to see those pictures.
Yeah. So, but. Yeah. Yes, ma'am?
Did you have to like work on your lung capacity at all, or did you get out of breath the first couple of times you started playing?
Yeah, you get, until you figure out how to do it, I think any wind player has that whole diaphragm thing kind of figured out after a while, and it's still a struggle because you go back and forth between here and then here too to get them. Yes, ma'am.
Is it like circular breathing, or are you just breathing really fast?
I don't do circular breathing. I put a lot of effort into trying it, and I know some players that can do that. For me, I put so much effort into it, and then the payback was like, okay, I can hold a note. Sustain it indefinitely, so I gave up on it.
How do you alternate between notes and the harmonica so quickly? Like, for example, when you're playing the very fast sections of the blues song.
I cover a section of four holes with my mouth, and I blow, well, I mean, and my tongue is blocking out the three, so I'm blowing out of a chamber on my right, so my tongue is going back and forth very, very, very quickly to make that air chamber move. My tongue's going back and forth. It's not, that's how I do it. Other guys play with just a pursing thing and they can get it that way. But there is a particular sound to it, what we call a tongue blocker. So. Anybody else? Yes, ma'am?
It doesn't have to do with harmonicas, but how did you commute?
We met teaching.
We met, yeah.
I was his boss.
She was my boss.
I was department chair for a long time, and he did a good job. He did not get paperwork, though, so when he left to go do music more full-time and work at the Paramount, I was mad, though, initially, because it's like I got to volunteer, which I still like doing, and I'm still friends with people. They started volunteering, but literally, he was there about 15 minutes, and they said, "We're going to pay you. Come here. We need help." Yeah. So his career shifted at that point. But yes, we met teaching, and strangely enough, even though we're here now, we both grew up in New England, only like an hour apart.
Yeah.
So we have a lot of stuff in common, which we didn't realize until much later. And to go to your question about the air thing, if you ever happen to date or marry a harmonica player, do not let them eat before a gig, because it compresses like the lung capacity. It causes problems, so you can't eat before you play.
Yeah.
At least not a lot.
You know they're going to come up to the Hill House, and hopefully you're going to be able to be at the banquet for a few minutes. Did you see another question?
Right here.
Yeah.
It's for both of you, not related to harmonica. So what was your favorite live music experience that you got? When I was at Bonnaroo working, and I got to do Stevie Nicks and Tom Petty, that was pretty darn awesome. There's another one, not this year, but last year I was the venue operations manager for the Walk-In Music Festival, so all the headline acts rehearsed for 5 days, twice a day for 5 days, in a carriage house that's set further away on the property. And so it was me and the band. That was it for 5 days. So I got to basically hear the entire Lock-In main stage festival, just me and them, and talk to them and give them coffee and make more coffee. And it was really, that was very, very cool.
It's hard to pick. Mine, because my role is I'm mixing the artist and
maybe Chris Christopherson came in solo all by himself. We had 1,045 people. You could hear a pin drop. And I thought I mixed the event, the show, really, really well. And after the show, he came up, put his arm around me and said, that's the best sounding show I've had all year. So those are the kind of things. Or when I did B.B. King, it was, you know, you're mixing these iconic people and you do a good job and you know, you just kind of go, okay, I've done B.B. King. I'm done. Mic drop. I can go home. I don't have to do this anymore. You know, so you get a lot of those kind of moments.
Dalai Lama, for me, was like, that's still my screensaver, and it's been my screensaver for 4 years. If you look me up on Facebook, you'll see me and him. It'll never change. I don't really believe ever. Mm-hmm. I didn't get a picture with Maya Angelou, but she was absolutely amazing. And when I was working with her backstage, she's sitting there. She has a bad arthritis, so she's sitting on a stool waiting for her turn to go out, and she's like, well, tell me about yourself. And I'm like, okay. And I'm like, well, I'm a teacher. And she goes, I am so honored to meet you. And I'm like, you're honored to meet me? Are you kidding? It was just really amazing. And a lot of our volunteers have had opportunities to meet these people also, because we often have like meet and greets and that kind of thing. So another reason to volunteer.
Yeah. Or intern.
Or intern. So before we leave, because now we're like running out of time, we have 2 minutes. Raise your hands if you promise to come to the Paramount sometime before finals in the spring. Yes! We're holding you to it. Okay.
Please do.
We'll show you around as much as we can. They
have
had amazing experiences. They're amazing. Don't run off. We got a prize for you. Amazing people, amazing experiences. Hopefully you are energized by these people, because you too are going to be all amazing people doing amazing things for sure. Let's make sure that we give them another round of applause. We like to be the official Brown College mug, Brown College pen, and a Brown College lapel pin, which is only available.